Λοιπόν, ξεκινάμε με την πρώτη ομιλία. Την κάνει ο Κωστής ο Γοντικάκης. Έχετε πάρει τον τίτλο Searching the Transition Region Emissions of Corona Loops. Εδώ πέρα που πήγα να δείξω δεν υπάρχει τίποτα, το βλέπετε εσείς. Ξεκινάμε αμέσως για να είμαστε μέσα στα χρονικά μας περιθώρια. Σαν να είσαστε εδώ. Στο τέλος θα κάνετε τι ερωτήσεις θέλετε.
Θα βάλω τη μάσκα.
Ή όχι. Όχι, δεν βάλω τη μάσκα.
Βγάλω τη μάσκα, πάμε και πίσω
εμείς. Οπότε θα την κάνω στα αγγλικά.
Έτσι είναι, έτσι έχουμε πει. Δεν βλέπω κανέναν αγγλόφωνο μέσα, οπότε...
So, okay, let's see.
My English.
Fine, so good morning. Sorry for this delay. And I will speak. This is a collaboration, an ongoing collaboration. This is an ongoing research that it's going on with Spiros Antiochos, and we
are louder
with Spiros Antiochos, and we are working on the thermal structure of coronal loops. Στο πω, ακούω, μιλάμε μικροφωνισμό, τέλος πάντων.
Μπορείτε να κάνουμε κανένα μήνυμα εδώ.
Αν μπορείς, βγες και κλείσω για το.
Δεν μπορούμε να το κάνουμε
δυνατά. Ναι, θα προσπαθώ. Πόσο μπορεί να δω. Γιατί όταν μιλάς στην οθόνη, ξέρεις, έχεις την τάση να μιλάς.
Ναι, να μιλάς μετά.
Βλέπετε, μου φαίνεται πως... Βλέπετε έτσι το πειραματικό του θέματος. Θέλω να εγώ συνεχίζω, έτσι. So here this is an introductionary view graph on the solar corona. These are images that I show here taken by an instrument, AIA, that takes full disk images of the corona every 10 seconds. We will have the occasion later on to speak on this data. So here you have the first row shows you images from the solar corona in the extreme ultraviolet. And so you have different wavelengths, shows they are dominated by different ions.
Δεν βλέπουμε τίποτα όμως.
Κάνε full screen την.
Ναι. Εμείς δεν βλέπουμε τίποτα.
Ωχ, είναι κακό τώρα, δεν ξέρω γιατί συμβαίνει. Είναι full screen πάλος. Βλέπατε, το προηγούμενο αυτό το βλέπατε.
Βλέπουμε από τον υπολογιστή σου μάλλον, ξέρω εγώ. Να.
Share screen μήπως έχεις κάνει.
Έχω κάνει, ναι. Έχω κάνει share screen.
Εγώ βλέπω την πρώτη διαφάνεια που είναι και, και αριστερά, δεν ξέρω οι άλλοι τι βλέπουν.
Τίτλος, τον τίτλο βλέπουμε.
Το τίτλο και αριστερά βλέπω τα slides που έχει στο PDF αυτό που
ωραία.
Έχει.
Ωραία. Μπορείς να κάνεις view στο...
Μισό λεπτό, δεν χρειάζεται να είναι εδώ πέρα αυτό λοιπόν. Να το σβήσουμε.
Slide view. Slide view κάνεις στον υπολογιστή σου.
Υπάρχει θέμα. Τώρα βλέπετε.
Ναι, ναι, ναι. Οκ. Okay.
Εντάξει.
Ναι.
So here...
Περίπου. Τώρα βλέπουμε αυτό που θα βλέπει ο παρουσιαστής. Κανονικά ναι. Θα πρέπει να βλέπουμε μόνο την αριστερή εικόνα, το slide.
Ναι, ναι, κατάλαβα. Αλλά προσπαθώ να δω πώς πω το... Εδώ πέρα βλέπετε καλά. Τώρα βλέπετε.
Ναι, αλλά μπορεί να κάνεις slide view για να το δούμε όλο.
Ναι, αλλά το κάνω slide view.
Φαίνεται και το...
Ωραία, εκεί
ναι,
μετά.
Ναι,
τώρα,
ναι.
Είναι, τώρα είναι σωστό. Okay.
Ωραία,
εντάξει.
Okay. Ναι. So, μήπως κρυώνεις, κάντε κρυώνα.
Όχι, όχι.
This is an inch.
Όπως το νέο σου μας, ανοίγω αυτή την πόρτα, αν θέλεις, για να έχουμε κυκλοφορία αέρα, αν κρυώνεις.
Όχι, εντάξει, δεν πειράζει.
Αν κρυώνεις, όμως είναι πιο ασκή.
Ας το καλά είναι τώρα, συνεχίζουμε. So, this is an introductionary view graph with images from AIA. The first row shows you the solar corona in different wavelengths. So different wavelengths correspond to different temperature of the plasma. The upper, here is the cursor. So this image here shows you plasma at about 6 million Kelvin. There you have 1 million Kelvin. And all these are images of the corona when you see these bright active regions. There in the middle, follow the cursor, right? You have the, an image in the ionized helium that shows you the transition region. So see, you still you have the same morphology, but you have the supergranulation network. And here in the corner, you have a magnetogram that was recorded at the photosphere, and you have the concentration of the magnetic fields that corresponds to the same areas when you have the bright active regions. So this is an indication that the corona is the heating of the corona when you have the production of large volumes of hot plasma that emits this in these wavelengths is connected with the magnetic field.
The different colors represent the different wavelengths.
Yes, the colors, they are not real colors. These are in the ultraviolet. And okay, they just recognize the different wavelengths.
And the last one?
The last one
is the magnetogram.
The magnetogram, yes. So now you have this is a global model of the solar atmosphere, which is the horizontal axis is the distance from the photosphere, the high in kilometers, and the horizontal axis is the temperature, which is so you see that the temperature decreases in at the level of the photosphere, decreases with altitude. And then in the chromosphere, you have a rising of the temperature. So the chromosphere is it's about on average, gross average, about 1,000 kilometers. You have a rising of the temperature because there is some mechanism there that produces heat. And then you have a very, according to the model, you have a very high rise of the temperature of about two orders of magnitude. That happens in a few 100 or 200 kilometers, and then you reaches the temperatures of the corona of 1 million Kelvin, and the spectral lines that I shows here shows you the formation temperatures more or less. So the iron 171 is at about 1 million Kelvin, and the 284. Is emitted by an ion which is has less electrons, and so this is why the temperature is higher. And the question that we'll be talk about here is that in this model, the energy is dominated by the conduction from the heat that is released in the corona. The conduction distributes this heating to lower temperatures down to the transition region. So this is the higher atmosphere is dominated by conduction according to this model. And now let's see a little bit the an active region here. You see two images of an active region. The left image is you see emission in the 171 over the AIA that I showed you before. And the right one is observed in X-rays. So in the left image, you see the plasma emitting radiation, a plasma that is about 1 million Kelvin, right on the, but on the right image, you have plasma that it's in about 5 million Kelvin. And what was observed is that the very bright and hot loops here correspond to this area that is called MOS, and you have a very small features, and it is believed that this MOS is at the foot points of the very bright loops, very bright X-ray loops. And what you see here, you have conduction, thermal conduction of the very hot X-ray loops down to the temperatures of 1 million Kelvin. The problem has been for many years, from down to the 70s, that we do not have observed examples of the conduction from 1 million Kelvin down to the transition region. It seems that there are other mechanisms that are taking place in this lower atmosphere, that the plasma of the transition region is almost independent of what is going on in the corona. However, for the question. And an example here is from a paper of Angelos Vouglidas with M. Klimchak of 2001. Then when they compare the emission from in the Lyman alpha with data from the Volt rocket, if I manage to find it. Okay, here's the cursor. So this is the MOS area observed with the rocket in the Lyman alpha of hydrogen, which is emitted at just the beginning of the transition region. When you compare this, and the lower image is from the 1 million Kelvin. Now, for most of the coronal lines, the coronal lines are optically thin, and they are dominated by collisions between free electrons and ions, and you can describe the line intensity that you see here as a product of the square of the electron density of the free electrons times the size L of the structure along the line of sight times a contribution function which includes all the atomic parameters that are necessary for the production of the photons, the spontaneous emission of Einstein coefficients, anyway, and this quantity, it depends on the temperature. Now you can compute this quantity, the emission measure, from these observations. You cannot distinguish between them. It's most difficult to measure separately the density and the size, but you can compute quite easily the emission measure. And now Vouglidas et al. Computed that for a steady state loop dominated by conduction, the ratio of the emission measures computed from trace from 1 million and from Malam and alpha is equals the ratio of the temperatures at 3/4. And this is close to 10. So this is a measurement that you can done easily. These are their results in the lower scatter plot. And in fact, just to confuse you ahead, this is an inverse ratio, which has values of 50 up to 200, which correspond to the theoretical ratio fails to explain, which means that you cannot have in these features, you can't have a few ones at least that go on dominated by conduction down to the transition region. And this is what we are trying to do, the same experiment using a solar flare data where the coronal loops are very bright and are perhaps not influenced by a cooler material that could be along the line of sight. Now I will present you the data that we use. This is an active region observed in September 2014. And during a very an X-class flare, I show you here a very small model, very figurative, what is going on during a flare. You have the release of the energy. So this was taken by Ben's paper, Living Reviews. You have the release of the energy on the top of coronal loops, very schematically I talk. Particles are accelerated and they are moving along the magnetic field toward the chromosphere. There they collide with the dense chromospheric plasma. You have bright features that develop here. And here the plasma is heated and to temperatures of about 10 million Kelvin, and they are rising up along these magnetic fields, a phenomenon that is called chromospheric evaporation. Evaporation is not a right term, but this is how it's called. And then these loops are very bright, and we call them post-flare loops. So this is what you will see in this video that I hope you will run. So this is a video when you see the loops here, they're connecting the ribbons. Here you have the precipitation and the chromospheric evaporation that develops. You have the motion of these ribbons that is caused because you have successive coronal loops that are participating in the flare. And then you have this, okay, I will start it perhaps once more time. And you see, so here you have the AIA images, and you have the emission of 10 million Kelvin, perhaps not more, only 10 million. I will speak about it later. And now, during this observation with AIA, we have an observation with a spectrograph, with the iris spectrograph that you see here. So here you will see a movie on the same area, but now in the transition region. And here this dark line is the plate, the slit of the spectrogram. So during the observation, you have a movie, and on the same time, you have also a spectrum that is selected. So now you will have all going on. You have the structure, you have sunspots here, low-lying loops. This is a plasma that is formed at about 80,000 Kelvin. And you will see here, you see the emission of two silicon four lines. And now you will see the ribbons that will develop. This is one of the best spatial resolutions that we have up to now for observing such events. Here you have the development of the bright ribbons. And now I will show you the spectrum. So this image here is what we said, a sit and stare raster. So you have at the position that you see here, along the slit, you have an intensity every 10 seconds. And from this, you form this image here. So the horizontal axis is the time. The vertical axis is the position along the slit from south to north. So all the first part is nothing has happened. And the last half an hour, you have the development of the flare. And here you have the intensity of this spectral line here, the silicon line, the one of the two of them. And now the iris spectrum has also more spectra. You have here it also observed along with the silicon line, also an iron 21 line. Here you have an example of a single spectrum. You have many chromospheric lines, and you have also this huge line that is blue shifted. In fact, normally the position of the line is here. It is blended with this single carbon line. And you have a blue shift of about 150 kilometers per second due to the chromospheric evaporation. As you see here, this is the intensity image of this line. And I selected these black dots here along a loop that you follow the function of time. Here you have the evolution of the intensity, And here you have the Doppler shift that starts from about -200 kilometers per second and decreases as a function of time, and in a few minutes, it becomes, crosses zero, and then it becomes redshift. So you have, at the beginning, you have the chromospheric evaporation that takes place here. Then the loops are very bright because they are fed with very hot plasma from below. Then they are started to cool. So you have the formation of post-flare loops, and then these loops are cooling down and they're raining back the plasma with low velocities. Now we have this data, and what we want to know, we want to, as I said in the beginning, to examine the comparing to see if you can have a hot emission measure and cool emission measure along the same loop dominated by conduction. So we try to compare the AIA in the 131, these images here that I show you in the first movie, with this data. So now here, this spectrum shows you what is observed by the AIA in the 131. You have a very this iron 21 line. It is the same iron that emits also the iris spectral line. And you also have some cool plasma here from some iron 8 lines. So, and here, this is a response of the instrument of the AIA that I showed here by this image. It has two components. One component at 10 million Kelvin that is produced by this blue line, and a cool component, which is about, I think it's about a few hundred thousand Kelvin, cooler one. And this is the contribution function, the contribution function from the iris spectral line. So in order to, so we want to measure the emission measure in these two radiations and to compare them in order to see if we have only hot plasma or perhaps we have also cool plasma in these images. To do that, we have to transform the movie of the AIA into such a form here, like this one, in order to compare them. Therefore, we took all the images of the AIA and took the position of the slit of iris. It is crossing the ribbons here in this time. And we took this, took the intensity and form images like this one. So here, this image is from iris. It is a spectrum, the spectrum, I repeat, the horizontal line is the time. And here we created this image when we could compare both of them. So here we have many problems of saturation of the detector. You can see here this, I manufactured somehow the image and I was able to hide the saturation effects, but they are here. And now in this view graph below, you have a comparison of the emission measure along this position here, just at the beginning of the flare, when the flare starts to cross the slit. The gray line comes from the emission measure of the AIA data, and the histogram is the emission measure from the iris data. And where you see that the gray line is higher than the histogram, that means that you also have a kind of a cool plasma that is that gives photon to create this image. When they're exactly equal, that means that you see only hot 10 million plasma in both instruments. Well, to be honest, when you have the iris, which is higher, I don't know really what's going on. I have to check it more. In this image, however, we have a problem. This section was taken about this area, 455 seconds. Then we have definitely a problem of saturation. And I will try to see if it is possible to correct it. Apparently there are some works. This is an ongoing work, okay? So in this, we want to use this data in order to check the contribution of cool plasma with the hot plasma. Now let's go to other spectral lines. Here we analyze the silicon 4 spectrum. We have here the intensity. Again, the horizontal axis is the time, and the vertical axis is the section from south to north. And you have different individual spectral profiles taken from this area. For example, this spectrum is coming from here, from this area, a very bright area. I have to say that this part here is saturated. You cannot use it. These two spectra here, you see, you follow the cursor, this one and this one, comes from between the two ribbons. So this area is not affected by the flare. This area here comes from the lower ribbon. Here you can use it. And these are coming from the post-flare loops. So from the area above. And what you see in all of them is that you you can describe the profiles with two spectral components. Here, for example, in this profile, the histogram are the data, and you have two curves, two Gaussians can describe this profile. This is happening almost everywhere, and you have, for most of the cases, the same pattern, a high intensity, narrow profile, and a low intensity, broad profile. In all the cases, these profiles are redshifted. They show plasma going toward the surface. In contrast, what you see in the very hot plasma, this is something that is known, more or less, that the cool plasma during the flares shows motions in general toward the surface. An exception is the profile here that have two equal intensity profiles. So these are coming from an area around there. And now I did images. So the first row shows you the intensities in the two components. The lower row shows you the Doppler shifts. And what I think is that you have the same morphologies here and there, except perhaps in this area here where you see the two very strong components. So this might say that we have different mechanisms going on in the same feature. This is how I interpret the interpretation that we have the same morphology. Okay, morphology, this axis is time, right? In other researchers of other papers, the explanation is that the broad profile is caused by oscillations in the loops. So it may be that the one component have a typical plasma of the loop, motions along the loop, and the broad one is the part of the plasma that is affected by waves. Now, another spectral line, which is very difficult, is the iron 12 observed by Iris again. This is a very important line because it's a coronal line emitted at about 1.5 million Kelvin. It's very useful for our work. However, the problem is that it's a very faint line. Here I show you some examples of individual profiles. Just tell me, you look this, the histogram are the profile and the continuous line is the Gaussian fit. So you have some examples that are more or less successful, but in other cases, the profile, the Gaussian fit fails. And so this is why I just summed up the counts in the profiles, and I was able to construct this image here, which I can compare with the silicon fault. So this, you have the iron 12 line. So even if it's a very faint line, you can see the same features more or less here. And there we compared the emission measure ratio. So how do you compute the emission measure? You take the intensity, you take the calibration to have physical units, and you divide by the contribution functions that we took at the maximum temperature of formation of the ions. And then you compare compute the emission measure. Here is a map of the ratio of the two emission measures of the iron over silicon. And this bright area, you have these bright areas here that correspond to the post-flare loops. The ribbon is very dark. And along one of these structures, I took the ratios of the two components, the component A, which is the sharp and the narrow and high intensity one, and the component B. And in the best examples, we have a ratio which is equal around 3 to 4 on average, while the theory expects you to find something around 10. So this is the big component that gives you the good result, let's say, that is should originate, or the thing that it is originated by oscillations. Well, this is a new result. I guess that the right comparison should be done with this component that is originating from the narrow and high intensity one component of the profile. So the first result is perhaps better than the one presented by Vouglides et al. 20 years ago. We have a result that is closer to the theory, but it's not this one yet. I believe that we need more study of this data. This data has more informations that are not fully explored yet. So I will give you the conclusions. We study a solar flare in order to find if it is possible to find structures that are dominated by a conduction, where you see a conduction in taking place from the corona down to the transition region, something that, to my knowledge, have not been found yet. The data, we have very good instruments now, and IRIS, the opportunity with IRIS is that the spatial resolution is very good. The area when you have this conduction dominated is very small. It has spatial scales of the order of 200 kilometers. And perhaps this is the reason why it was not able to find it yet, because the instruments did not have such a good resolution. We did, this is an ongoing project. We didn't have yet results that are satisfying the theory. Perhaps there are cases when the ratio is close to 10, the ratio of the emission measures. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much. This is, as I said, an ongoing project.
Okay. Questions, please. Anyone who has a question for the speaker? Do you hear us?
Πολύ ενδιαφέρουσα η ομιλία σου, Κωστή.
Ευχαριστώ.
Για πες μου τώρα, πόσο καλός είναι ο θεωρητικός υπολογισμός του λόγου των μέτρων εκπομπής?
Ο θεωρητικός λόγος βασίζεται σε ένα υδροστατικό μοντέλο. Το οποίο
δεν είναι σωστό, βέβαια, το υδροστατικό μοντέλο, δεδομένου ότι και μόνο ότι έχεις την evaporation χαλάει την υδροστατική ισορροπία.
Σωστά. Αλλά εμείς είχαμε κατά νου τους βρόχους, οι οποίοι σαφώς στην αρχή έχουν evaporation, αλλά στη συνέχεια έχουν μια πολύ χαμηλή κίνηση πίσω, χαμηλές ταχύτητες, οπότε μπορείς να πάρεις υπόψη σου το υδροστατικό μοντέλο, εφόσον δεν έχεις πολύ μεγάλες ταχύτητες.
Αυτό εξαρτάται από την κινητική ενέργεια σε σχέση με την θερμική πυκνότητα ενέργειας και αυτό μπορεί να υπολογιστεί, βέβαια. Δεν είναι πολύ.
Ναι, η αλήθεια είναι ότι προς το παρόν κοιτάζω τα δεδομένα κυρίως. Τα δεδομένα έχουν πάρα πολλά προβλήματα και σαφώς πρέπει να ελεγχθεί και η θεωρία λίγο περισσότερο, αυτό είναι αλήθεια. Αλλά θεωρούσα ότι
τα δεδομένα σου είναι καλά, είναι τα καλύτερα που μπορεί να έχει κανείς, αλλά ακόμα, όπως και εσύ είπες, η διακριτική ικανότητα και θα πρόσθετα και η ευαισθησία του IRIS στις γραμμές χαμηλής έντασης δεν είναι η επιθυμητή. Έτσι δεν είναι?
Ναι, η γραμμή του σιδήρου 12 έχει πολλά προβλήματα. Είναι πάρα πολύ αμυδρή και εκεί πέρα αυτό που έχω κάνει σε αυτές τις εικόνες είναι ότι έχω προσθέσει μεταξύ τους accounts με πρόβλημα μάλλον να έχει πάρει σφρίση και συνεχές μέσα, background. Οπότε εδώ πέρα μάλλον εγώ έχω μια υπερεκτίμηση της έντασης, έτσι.
Ναι.
Δεν ξέρω, θα προσπαθήσω να το ξαναδώ αυτό, άμα δω δηλαδή κάτι ενδιαφέρον που αξίζει τον κόπο να το βελτιώσω. Η άλλη ιδέα που δουλεύουμε είναι αντί να πάρουμε τη γραμμή του σιδήρου 12 από το IRIS, να πάρουμε εικόνες του AIA στο 171. Για να κάνουμε τη σύγκριση, αλλά βέβαια εκεί πέρα δεν έχει τους ίδιους χρόνους, δεν έχει την ίδια διακριτική ικανότητα και μέχρι τώρα δεν έχω βγάλει κάτι. Δεν τα παρουσίασα τα δεδομένα γιατί έχουν ακόμα προβλήματα.
Θα πρέπει να έχεις blends και στα 171 πάντως. Οι μπάντες του AIA είναι αρκετά
Ναι, αλλά αυτό που λέγεται είναι ότι έχεις μορφολογικά, είσαι πάρα πολύ κοντά, δηλαδή στη μεταβατική ζώνη των βλόχων στο 171. Αυτό δηλαδή είναι το οποίο είναι το...
Είναι η άνω μεταβατική ζώνη στο 171.
Ναι, ναι, αυτό ψάχνουμε να δούμε. Ναι. Υποτίθεται πως το 171 το έχεις αυτό, αλλά πρέπει να ψάξω περισσότερο να δω πόσο καθαρή είναι αυτή η μπάντα, αυτό είναι αλήθεια.
Μήπως θα μπορούσες να χρησιμοποιήσεις άλλες φασματικές γραμμές που να φαίνονται καλύτερα στα φάσματα του Άρης?
Το Άρης έχει αυτό το κακό. Έχει τις φασματικές γραμμές του πυρητίου, του άνθρακα, του ουδέτερου άνθρακα, αλλά δεν έχει φασματικές γραμμές του στέμματος. Εκτός από αυτή τη σίδερο 12, δεν έχει κάτι άλλο. Έχει αυτή το σίδερο 21. Το σίδερο 21 είμαστε πολύ μακριά από την μεταβατική ζώνη, σαν να λέμε. Δεν μπορείς να το χρησιμοποιήσεις τόσο πολύ για αυτή τη δουλειά.
Πολύ μεγάλη θερμοκρασία πρέπει να έχει ο σίδερος 21.
Ναι, είναι 10 εκατομμύρια Κέλβιν.
Ναι. Και δεν είναι θέμα μεταβατικής ζώνης. Αυτά τώρα, αν έχεις ένα σχηματισμό με 5 εκατομμύρια, μπορεί να είναι οπουδήποτε αυτός ο σχηματισμός. Δεν σημαίνει ότι ο σχηματισμός παντού ακολουθείται αυτή η ομαλή, πώς να το πω, άνοδος θερμοκρασίας. Μπορείς να έχεις ένα πολύ ζεστό loop μέσα σε ένα loop, δηλαδή 5 εκατομμύριων βαθμών, μέσα σε ένα περιβάλλον, ξέρω εγώ, 1 εκατομμυρίου. Μπορεί να είναι οπουδήποτε, δηλαδή.
Ναι, γενικώς, άμα θέλεις να ελέγξεις εκεί που η αγωγή θερμότητας παίζει τον κύριο ρόλο, πρέπει να βρεις φασματικές γραμμές γύρω στο 1 εκατομμύριο Κέλβιν για να έχεις το πάνω μέρος. Άμα πας στα 10 εκατομμύρια, είναι πλέον σε άλλο κομμάτι ενεργειακό. Έτσι.
Σίγουρα είναι άλλη υπόθεση στα 10 εκατομμύρια.
Ναι, ναι, ναι. Αλλά παρόλα αυτά μπορείς να βλέπεις και. Πώς το λένε, άμα κάνεις τη σύγκριση με το 131, σου λέει ότι αυτή η δουλειά έχει γίνει, δηλαδή από την Ίνες, ότι μπορείς να δεις ποιο κομμάτι, να ελέγξεις αν υπάρχει ψυχρό πλάσμα ή όχι. Έχει κάνει μια τέτοια δουλειά. Γι' αυτό και σαν επικουρικά, ας πούμε, το έχω το σίδερο 21.
Πάντως είναι τόσο τεράστια η βάση δεδομένων του Άρης, που ίσως θα μπορούσε να βρει κανείς άλλα παραδείγματα, όπου η χαμηλή ένταση γραμμή να είναι περισσότερο έντονη και πιο εύκολα μετρήσιμη.
Ναι, το πρόβλημα είναι το... Α, ναι. Εντάξει, γενικώς, άμα ψάξεις κανείς για πιο μεγάλη ένταση, θα έχεις πρόβλημα γιατί οι άλλες γραμμές θα πάθουν κόρο. Έχει το θέμα είναι να βρεις παρατηρήσεις που έχουν περισσότερο χρόνο έκθεσης. Οπότε να έχει καλύτερη δειγματοληψία ο άνθρακας 4, αλλά ο άνθρακας 12, θέλω να πω. Δεν ξέρω, μπορεί να έχουν γίνει σε κλάμψη, αυτό θα ξανά το δει κανείς. Ναι, αυτό είναι αλήθεια.
Θα μπορούσε βέβαια κανείς να ολοκληρώσει κάποιες εικόνες. Θα χάσει βέβαια διαχειριστική ικανότητα στον χρόνο.
Αυτό είναι, ναι.
Αλλά θα κερδίσει ως προς την ανιχνευσιμότητα του σίδηρου 12.
Ναι, αλλά μετά όμως βασικά θες να χρησιμοποιήσεις το ARS επειδή έχει καλή διακριτική ικανότητα και μπορεί να απομονώσει δομές. Έτσι είναι. Αυτό είναι.
Άρα, πολύ ωραία. Ευχαριστώ.